How's that?
Yeah, what's your line?
Hey guys, we're Evan and Katelyn.
And today we're gonna show you how to cut complex shapes on your CNC.
With Fusion 360.
Software tutorials aren't always the most engaging thing, so we're gonna use as little screen caps as possible, break it down into digestible bits, include real life examples, and make it easy to follow whether you're new to CNC or you have just enough experience to be dangerous. So first off, we're gonna go over the different types of carving that a CNC can do. Most common are outlines around a shape or flat surfaces at different depths.
You can make a lot of really cool stuff using just these types of cuts.
But you can also carve more 3D looking shapes or do really complex designs with multiple flat surfaces, way more than you would want to calculate manually.
It's no big deal for a computer, but a computer doesn't know what's in your head. So here's how to tell it what's in your head.
First, you need a 3D CAD model of the thing you want to carve. You can design one yourself or download existing models to use. Then you show the CNC how to carve this model from your stock material. This process is called CAM. Next, you load these instructions into your machine control software, in this case, Easel. Click run, and your CNC takes those instructions and starts carving. So this video is about how you cut fancy things on your CNC, not how to model them in the first place. So we're gonna skip over CAD and save that tutorial for another time.
But we'll have a link to the file we're using below so you can follow along with us.
This means we're jumping straight into CAM, which is the meatiest part of our tutorial.
Meaty.
In order to explain all these steps, we're gonna show you how to make Kevin.
This is Kevin.
I know we said we'd try to minimize screen captures, but for this next part, there's no avoiding them. If we go too fast, there's a link to our written tutorial below so you can move at your own pace. Plus, we have a link to Kevin's file so you can follow along. We also included timestamps for easy navigation. Open your model in Fusion and click on the CAM tab. You'll start by creating a new setup. This is where you'll define 1. What the raw material is, 2. How your model is oriented, and 3, what you want to end up with.
We'll start with the stock tab. You can define your material or stock directly in the setup tab. But we like to model the actual stock in CAD and then define the stock from solid using the body we made. This is nice because you can move your model around within the stock, see where it's going to end up, and then regenerate your toolpaths later. In this example, we'll use a piece of walnut that's 8 inches long, 5 inches wide, and 3/4 inches thick.
If your model is not oriented correctly, you can easily change your work coordinate system by selecting the top of your stock for the Z-axis and an edge for the X-axis. Then choose the origin from your stock box point or model box point. The origin shows your machine what point it should consider to be zero, aka its starting or home point.
Some machines auto-home to a certain point, so you should set your origin to that location. For Carvey, that is the top of your material in the bottom left corner. But for a lot of other machines, like the X-Carve, you can set your home point almost anywhere. We pick a spot that makes sense for the model, like the middle of the piece or a corner.
In general, you want to choose the top of your material as the home point. And that's because if you pause, stop, or finish your carving, it will often try to return to home, and if your home set at the bottom, it'll try to eat through the material to get there. Now that you're done with the setup, we need to tell Fusion what tool you're gonna use to cut. But first, a quick tip for you. Make sure to enable your cloud library, that way your tools, post-processors, and other assets are easily shareable between computers. Open up your tool library, then click on your cloud library and add a new mill tool. Select the type of cutter, most likely a flat end mill, and enter the dimensions of your tool, measuring with calipers. We like to also enter the speeds and feeds here, so they're saved in the cloud too.
The speed is how fast the bit rotates, but some machines won't use this input, like the X-Carve, so you can skip this step if you want. The carve ease speed can change, but in most cases you'll want to do 12,500 RPM, since that's the most efficient for the motor. The cutting and plunge feed rates are probably the most important numbers here, because they determine how quickly the bit moves through material, but that depends on your machine, material, and tool. We actually use Easel to cheat on this. Tell it your setup, and if you click on cut settings, it'll tell you a feed rate, plunge rate, and depth per pass.
Next, you define the tool paths, which are the paths the tool is going to take to cut your model out of the material. This sounds daunting, but there's preset options you can choose from and customize. You can quickly simulate cuts to see what each path does and see if there's any errors, and you can even layer multiple paths. First, we'll do an overview of some useful toolpaths, and then we'll dive deep into one of them to show you how to customize them. The toolpath we usually start with is adaptive clearing.
This is essentially an easy button to rough out your shape from the stock as efficiently as possible. It makes room for your tool to do more detailed passes later. This could be used as the only operation, or you can leave stock and finish it up in further operations.
Parallel passes are great for cleaning up rounded areas. We like doing two sets, perpendicular to each other. Things like circular and pocket clearing are great for cutting recessed areas out of your model. Our final toolpath is usually a 2D contour. This is a nice, smooth last pass, and it also has the option to add tabs. These are great because they keep your final model in place when it's being carved, and they're easy to remove once you're done.
Any path you choose has further details you can customize. We'll dive into adaptive clearing options so you can see how to handle these details. You start in the Tool tab, where you pick the tool you defined earlier. Notice that the feed rates entered earlier come with it.
The Geometry tab defines what will be cut out of how much stock. We choose an offset from the model to carve within the boundaries of. Otherwise, the machine thinks it should eat away literally all of your stock. We usually select Silhouette, which restricts the toolpath to a boundary around your part. Then we add some additional offset larger than the diameter of your tool so it can fit all the way in. If your offset is too small, the tool may not be able to reach where it needs to cut the model out.
Rest machining might need a little bit of an explanation. It's basically asking where it should begin machining the rest of your model. For the first toolpath you make, choose From Setup Stock. Further passes will usually get From Previous Operations.
This is also where you'll define what you want your end result to be, by choosing the body or bodies you want to cut out.
The Heights tab defines movements of the tool, such as clearance and retraction, and the defaults are usually fine for basic toolpaths.
The Passes tab is very important. This is where you define how aggressive the depth of your cuts are, called out here as step down. Remember the depth of cut we referenced earlier that we grabbed from Easel? This is where you enter it.
You should also pay attention to the stock to leave option. Picture this as a protective bubble of material around your model. When you're doing curves and slopes and want to layer additional finishing tool paths after your adaptive clearing path, you need to leave a little bit of extra meat to cut into. On the other hand, if you're doing just one operation to get your final product, you can leave this option unchecked.
For this topographical Texas we made a while back, we liked the layered look left by just the adaptive clearing pass, so we left it unchecked. But for Kevin, we wanted that protective bubble of stock so that we could do a 3D parallel pass or two to finish with finer detail.
The linking tab is probably only for advanced users and can be left at the default settings. Click OK and watch your toolpath generate.
And now you can simulate your carving to get a preview of what you'll end up with.
All right, guys, you made it through the toughest steps.
It's pretty easy from here.
To finish up, you need to select a post processor so that Fusion can export cutting directions, called G-code, in a way that your specific machine can understand.
So remember how we enabled Cloud Library earlier for our tools? This also added an asset library where we can store CAM posts between machines too. Add the post processor you need for your machine here.
You can either post-process the entire setup you created with all the layered toolpaths, or you can pick just one toolpath from your setup to post-process.
When you're ready, right-click on the setup or a specific toolpath and click post-process. Then find the post-processor for your machine, whether this is local or in the cloud, select the post-processor, then click post.
All right, so you have some G-code. It's a little .nc file saved on your computer.
Next, open up the machine control software for your machine, which is Easel for the Carve and X-Carve. The process will be the same for any similar CNC machine. Import the G-code file and you'll see the toolpath show up.
Click Carve, go through the checks, and you're good to go. But before you carve, we have another quick tip for you.
If you want to test your G-code before running it on expensive wood,
you could run it on cheap material or in the air.
Okay. Let's take this little guy out.
He's really cute.
So at this point, we haven't sanded Kevin at all.
And you can see how smooth the combination of toolpaths we did got the finished surface.
Real quick, we wanted to say thank you to everyone who supports us over on Patreon. This isn't a sponsored project, but it took a lot more time and effort than the usual build.
Because of the awesome folks over at our Patreon, we can put out content like this for free. So if you find value in what we do, please consider supporting us over at patreon.com/EvanandKaitlin.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Hi, I'm Kevin. Please to meet. Oh, so excuse me.
Oh. Yay! You made it to the end of the video! We know that this is a lot of information to take in, but it really opens up so many opportunities with your CNC.
But you can always watch the video twice if you want, or more.
Yes, please.
Let us know if you have any questions in the comments below. And if you haven't subscribed, you should subscribe and make sure to hit that bell thing. That thing's cool. It notifies you of things when we upload videos and stuff.
And if you want to see behind the scenes stuff and extra info, we have an after show as well. And you can check that out at patreon.com/EvanandKaitlin. Don't know my lines. Oh, that's so cute. As few screen caps as possible.
It's like, you look like you're celebrating, but it looks like you're celebrating that you're gonna kill me.
Hi, I'm Kevin. I'm slippery. I like to dance. I'm Kevin.
Oh, we loves Kevin. She looks a little unsure.
Show them what she thinks about Kevin.
We're sorry, Kevin. We're sorry.